Thank you everybody for coming. Thank you for meeting. And we are really proud in our Middle East Society and also AGS's She's a Wine program to have a discussion about the Iran nuclear deal. As you can see, the slide behind us shows a group of smiling individuals at the time when the signature had taken place. So we're very happy to have two speakers. So I'll start with the speaker who's going to start speaking, who is Mr. Amir Aslani, a lawyer and a person who has written and continues to write a lot about Iran and about the situation in Iran, and Sanam Shalvaei, who is a journalist, France 24, and has also, in fact, our Middle East Society has already had the pleasure of having had her come and speak, so she's also going to be speaking about about the nuclear deal, where we're going, and what would happen if, and I'll leave three sort of dots. So I'll leave it to you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity that is given to us to be able to address ourselves to the class of 2018 at the AGS. I'm proud to be here. I'm also proud to be able to speak before Sana, because it will avoid an embarrassment for me if I were supposed to speak after her. That's how knowledgeable she is. I apologize for the way I'm dressed. I've got a function immediately after. I've got to hit the road immediately after the speech. I don't do pardon. I am originally from Iran. I practice law in Paris. I've been practicing law for the last 29 years. And as the mentioned, I have written extensively about Iran. I'm passionate about the Middle East in general, and Iran in particular. I am regularly questioned by French parliamentary commissions, European parliamentary commissions, the armies about the Middle East, what the Middle East is about, the Iran-Saudi conflict, the nuclear deal, Trump administration's advent and what the consequences of Trump's policy toward the Middle East are going to be in relation to the Iranian nuclear deal. So I'm going to talk to you about the Iranian nuclear deal and the confrontation that today is shaping the Middle East pursuant to the arrival of this young Saudi crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, also known as MBS to the Western media, and the consequences that his reckless policy, in my mind, may entail the Middle East. So as we all know, July 14th, 2015, a nuclear deal called the Joint Common Plan of Action was executed between the five current members of the Security Council, plus Germany, plus the European Union. This agreement was subsequently implemented in 2016, January 16th as a matter of fact. And here we are, November 2017, with this agreement severely questioned by the current U.S. administration. According to the provisions of U.S. domestic law, the U.S. president is required every 3 months to go before the United States Congress and determine whether Iran is in full compliance or not with its undertakings in relation to the nuclear agreement. October 14th, the Trump administration refused to certify Iran's compliance, actually decertified it, and this opened, according to U.S. laws and regulations, a 2-month, 60-day period. Within this time frame, the United States Congress has one of the following two options: either enact statutes that are going to impose upon Iran new sanctions, or enact statutes that compel the U.S. administration to renegotiate all or part of the JCPOA. The first option will require a simple majority of 51 senators, the second one, 60 senators. President Trump has already mentioned that in the event the U.S. Congress would not act on Iran, because according to the current U.S. administration, although Iran may be complying with the provisions of the JCPOA, Iran is not complying with the spirit of the JCPOA as a consequence of its ballistic missile test, as a consequence of its Middle East policy and the presence of pro-Iranian troops in a number of countries in the area, the Trump administration may take its own decision and withdraw the United States from the JCPOA. This comes at a very specific moment in history in the Middle East, whereby we have an erratic president of the United States whose behavior does not, in one way or the other, engage the entire American infrastructure. The State Department is not in agreement with the U.S. president. The Treasury is not in agreement with the U.S. president. The secret services are not in agreement with the U.S. president, but he's still the U.S. president. And this comes at a time whereby you have, in Saudi Arabia, a revolution that is taking place. 2 years ago, the Saudi government witnessed its first coup d'etat, whereby the first crown prince who became the king of Saudi Arabia today, Salman, decided to replace the second crown prince designated by his predecessor, King Abdullah, Mughreen, to replace Mughreen by his nephew, Mohammed bin Naif, known as MBN, and designate his own favorite son, Mohammed bin Salman, as second crown prince. First coup d'etat. Second coup, a couple of months ago, when the second crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, decided to overthrow, basically, his cousin, resigned from the position of crown prince, and he became the only existing crown prince today. The third coup d'etat took place less than 10 days ago, whereby we witnessed, 2 hours after the creation of an anti-corruption commission, the decision of the Saudi crown prince, designated by his father as president of this commission, to effectuate a number of arrests of hundreds of ministers, ex-ministers, advisors, 11 prominent princes, as well as the eldest son of King Abdullah, who was the head of the National Guard in Saudi Arabia, the only professional army corps in that country. Mohammed bin Salman today is the only crown prince. His father is sick, is old, is incapable to assume his responsibilities. There is talk of him suffering from severe Alzheimer's or dementia. So he is on a rampage in order to concentrate all existing powers within his own hands, so as to be able to become king of Saudi Arabia when, in a few months from now, his father would abdicate from his position. A 31-year-old crown prince, who was 29 when he was designated to his new responsibilities. At 29, he became defense minister. He became the head of the Economic Advisory Board of Saudi Arabia, which supervises the economic development of that country. He became head of the supervisory board of Aramco, only center of financial supplement resources for the country, and now president of his commission. Also designated as head of the private affairs department of his father, which implied the fact that he was the only person that controlled access to the king. Controlling the four most important functions in the country, he embarked upon what I consider his erratic diplomacy, both inside and his erratic domestic policy inside Saudi Arabia. It all began with Yemen, considering that in his mind, there is a legitimate government of Yemen, democratic government of Yemen, who, by the way, was never elected by anyone, because we're talking about President Abdu, who was designated within the framework of the agreement reached with President Ali Abdullah Saleh, who resigned in favor of this gentleman, who was a Saudi protege. Considering that this country is in the hands of Iran, whereby a Houthi rebel group, as they used to call them, has embarked upon a policy to overthrow the legitimate government, invaded Yemen 3 years ago. This has led to nearly 40,000 dead in the civilians in Yemen, 40,000, as a consequence of a lack of expertise of Saudi pilots who are afraid to bombard their military targets at acceptable heights, who bombard from 30,000 feet and their bombs fall upon everything, people, possessions, hospitals, schools, whatever. 40,000 civilians dead, and the Saudis are still 1,000 kilometers from the capital Sana'a, which is under Houthi control. The Houthis are not a civil rebel movement. They belong to half of the country's population that is basically Shia, and five Imam Shia. It's a very far version of the 12 Imam Shia that we have in Iran, but it is still closer to Shia than the Sunnis. They're still in power. It's costing Saudi Arabia $1 billion a month, and they have not made any progress, other than the capital of the southern part of Yemen is in the hands of Al-Qaeda today, and the Saudis have not made progress. First erratic decision. Second erratic decision, embarked upon the fight with Qatar, this teeny-weeny small country of 20,000 nationals, half of whom are women. They're Wahhabi like the Saudis, so the woman in their mind doesn't count. 100,000 people. This is smaller than the city of Melun, where you have the Volvicomte to Chateau, which I'm sure you've mentioned. That's Qatar. 6 months into the conquest of Qatar, the Qataris are still around, and the Saudi group aligned to compel the Qataris to abandon, quote-unquote, their terrorist policies has not led them anywhere. another initiative that is in the process of creating havoc in the country is what he's done recently with the royal family. 500 people imprisoned, major princes, because it's Saudi Arabia. Imprisonment in Saudi Arabia implies that they are imprisoned within the Ritz-Carlton Hotel. A week after a conference was held within that hotel for the purpose of attracting foreign investment, that's why the arrest of Prince Walid bin Talal, the billionaire Saudi who's the liberal face, business-oriented face of Saudi Arabia, was a horrendous mistake because this entailed a total lack of confidence with the country. Some people are concerned that this is a consequence of the a specific request of Donald Trump. As you may recall, bin Talal tweeted before the presidential election in the United States saying that Trump is an embarrassment to the GOP, the Republican Party, as well as the United States. A week before these arrests were effectuated, Jared Kushner, his son-in-law, President Trump's son-in-law, and also his advisor on the Middle East, traveled to Saudi Arabia and then to Israel. This entire scenario happened. All of this was followed by another incredible story, that of the resignation of the Lebanese prime minister on Saudi territory, on the Saudi television, reading a Saudi dictated resignation letter. And the fellow still is in Saudi Arabia, has not been authorized to return back to his country. There are posters going up in Lebanon here and there saying that give us back our prime minister. He's saying I'm free to travel, but just doesn't move. His phone was confiscated, his bodyguard was disarmed as soon as he landed over there. By the way, the president of Yemen is also under arrest in Saudi Arabia. This basically makes two heads of state that are kidnapped by the Saudi government today. Why are they doing this? Because there is this huge misconception that they are having in relation to Iran. The Saudis are under the genuine threat in their mind of what they used to consider as the Shia crescent, but which has become today the Shia full moon. Because when you look at the situation, you're looking at Iran to the north of Saudi Arabia. Iran to the north of Saudi Arabia, Iraq under Iranian control, Syria under Iranian control, Hezbollah under Iranian control, and now Yemen, the Saudis feel encircled, they feel threatened, and this feeling of absolute threat that they are going through is exasperated. But what they genuinely hate, that is what Iran is all about, and what is Iran as a civilization, as a country. The Saudis believe that they are in competition with Iran. They're in competition for dominating the Middle East. When you look at Iran, you're not looking at a country that resembles any of the other countries in the area. First of all, Iraq today, if Iraq is still standing, it is not because the Americans went there in time to control ISIS from taking over Baghdad. It's because the Iranians, who were present over there with their Iraqi allies, blocked the advance of the ISIS movement in Samarra to a kilometer north of Iraq and prevented their bill of the autonomous Kurdish region from falling. It was because of Iran that ISIS did not capture Iraq. It was because of Iran that Assad is still in power. I'm not saying that Assad is a great guy. He's a totalitarian murderer. Nobody questions that. But at the end of the day, if you had a choice between a totalitarian fellow and a group of people who sell women on the open market, who decapitate Christians, who crucify their decapitated bodies, I'd rather be with Assad than with Frankenstein. Lebanon, same thing. Hezbollah is in Lebanon. Hezbollah is an Iranian-created movement with a military and political dimension. It is a follow-up to what the Shah of Iran prior to the Iranian Revolution had already created himself. So it's not something that goes back to the Iranian Revolution. It goes back to the Shah's regime, because the Amal movement in Lebanon was the Shah's creation, created by the return to Lebanese territory of a Lebanese cleric called Imam Musa Saad, who is a Lebanese-Iranian icon of the Shia faith, who basically created the Amal movement so as to empower the Shia population over there. And in Yemen, what we're witnessing is that although the Shia in Yemen have not much to do with this 12 Imam version of the Shia faith in Iran, they are becoming Shia in the vengeful, hateful eyes of the Saudis. I have become Shia, although I'm a totally secular person, in the hateful eyes of the Saudis when they look at me. So when they look at Iran, they're seeing something that they don't like. Why? Because Iran is a civilization. Because Iran, at the end of the day, is a functioning state. It's a functioning society. It's a country whereby, contrary to all of the other countries that surround Iran, has a young population that is highly educated. Saudi Arabia also has a young population. As a matter of fact, 80% of the Saudi population is under the age of 30, whereas in Iran, 70% of the population is under the age of 40. The difference is that the level of education in Iran is higher than that of the average of Western Europe. That's what scares the Saudi people. What also scares them is that the rate of connectivity to the internet in Iran is higher than that of any other country in the area, including Israel. It is also because there are millions of Iranians living abroad, and these people are connected to their country. So the Iranians in Iran know what is going on around the globe. When the Saudis decided to grant the right to women to drive, and they're very grateful because this happened 2 years after we ended up with self-driving cars, Iran provided to the international community the first Muslim female Nobel laureate, the first female Fields Prize winner, who unfortunately passed away a couple of months ago. Women in Iran, although they are under the Iranian theocracy with its own versions of restrictive Islam, they are still a functioning part of the Iranian society, whether in Saudi Arabia, they can't even go through the same door. And when the Saudis look at Iran, basically speaking, they're scared. They're scared because the natural place of Iran, because of its civilization, because of its history, because when you look at Iran, you're looking at a civilization that does not only belong to the Iranians, it belongs to all the other countries that surround Iran. The glory of Turkey is a country called Rumi, whereby we celebrated his 800,000th anniversary birthday by UNESCO 2 or 3 years ago. And he never wrote anything aside from the Persian language. The glory of Azerbaijan is a person called Ganjavi, and he never wrote anything aside from Farsi. The glory of Kazakhstan, the University of Kazakhstan in Almaty, is called Farabi. And Farabi is after an Iranian philosopher who never wrote anything aside from the Farsi language. Samarkand and Bukhara in Uzbekistan are Farsi-speaking cities. The national anthem of Pakistan is in Farsi Persian. The Mughal civilization was a Farsi-speaking civilization. So when the Saudis look at Iran, they're seeing the only country that they invaded and that they did not manage to convert to the Arab language and to becoming a member of the Arab civilization. I'm writing a book, as a matter of fact, it's going to be published in a couple of months, that talks about the role of Islam in the making of the Muslim civilization. And Richard Fry passed away a few years ago, which is was an American citizen and an icon of expertise in relation to the civilization of Iran, used to say that the glory of the Persian Empire was under the Abbasid dynasty, and that's an Arab dynasty in Iraq. So the Saudis, when they look around, they see Baghdad, the capital of the Abbasid dynasty, Iranians in charge. When they see Damascus, the capital of the Umayyad dynasty, and they see Iranians in charge. Lebanon and Beirut, which is a cultural society, they see Hezbollah, they see Iranians in charge. When they look at Yemen, they see also Iran through the Zaydi movement over there, which they identify as the fifth column, the Shia faith. And when they look into their own country, they look at the northern province of Saudi Arabia, where 100% Saudi oil is concentrated, and where 100% of local population is Twelver Imam Shia, like the Iranians. They also look to the south of their country, to the Ismailis in Saudi Arabia, who are also adepts of a certain version of Islam. And what they are seeing over there is also Iran's image. Today, the fighting of the Houthi are leading in Saudi Arabia, is occurring in Saudi Arabia, on Saudi soil. The province of Jizan in Saudi Arabia is a subject of daily fighting between Houthi troops and Saudi army, and they cannot contain them. So today, when I hear the language of war against Iran, which has managed to occupy, directly or indirectly, a number of hearts, a number of countries, I see the Saudis, who can't even control their own neighbor to the south, the poorest, weakest Arab nation, to the concept of jingoism that is being conveyed today by the Saudi crown prince about going to war with Iran, is grotesque. But what is at stake at this stage, and what about Iran? Iran is not a democracy. At best, it's a semi-democracy. I cannot be a candidate in Iran for any function because there is a committee over there that decides who can be a candidate and who cannot be a candidate. But at the end of the day, you still have, within the spectrum of all the people that show up, people who come from opposite sides of the Iranian political spectrum. You have an anti-Semitic fanatic like Ahmadinejad, but you also have a smiling functioning, pragmatic president such as Rouhani. So Iran is a society whereby it is possible for the population, to some extent, to express their political desires through the exercise of the right to vote. This is not possible in Saudi Arabia. I usually say, you know, in 2008, we had contested elections in Iran with millions of Iranians in the streets protesting against the election of Ahmadinejad. I never heard anyone talk about contested elections and dispute elections in Saudi Arabia. Why? There are no elections in Saudi Arabia. So Iran is different. Iran is different because of this reason and because Iran's power, aside from its civilization, is also concentrated in its religion. The Shia faith is an expression of the Iranian identity. So now that the Iranians have recovered access to Najaf and Karbala in Iraq, which are extremely holy sites for the Iranians, sites during 30 years they didn't have access to, they are never going away. So when Eric Tillerson from Riyadh, standing next to Adel al-Jubayr, the Saudi foreign affairs minister, tell the Hashid, these are the Shia movements in Iraq created by the Iranians, and in Syria, to leave Iraq and leave Syria, my first line was, leave, to go away. They are Iraqis. They are Syrians. They are Lebanese. 65% of the population of Iraq is Shia. For 1,000 years, whether it be under Saddam or under the Islamic dynasties of the first centuries or under the Ottoman Empire, they were continuously ruled by the Sunnis, prevented them from having access to the functions of the civil service or the army. They were always excluded, so that's why the Shia are usually most educated in these Arab countries, dominated by Sunnis, because they end up being doctors, medical practitioners, lawyers, professors. They are never going to accept any minority ruling over them, never. And the Iranians will never leave the southern part of Iraq, because for them, it is the most sacred part religious geography. They will never abandon Syria, not because there is a religious monument over there, and actually there is one in Damascus, but because they invested so much money, so much blood of their own people in propping up the Assad regime, that they feel entitled to staying over there. They will never let go of Hezbollah, which, by the way, is part of the functioning Lebanese government. It's only its military branch that was designated as a terrorist organization, but the political part is a legitimate elected form of a party that is part of the Lebanese government, and it's not going anywhere because it is in the Iranian mind, and according to Israelis also, who fought a war to a standstill against Hezbollah in 2006, the most performing, strongest light infantry in the world. And they're now not leaving Yemen because they have become Yemenis themselves, as they've heard so much the Saudis point fingers at them and designate the Shia in Yemen as the fifth column of the Iranian regime, they feel now compelled to defend the Houthis in Yemen. And the Houthis, by the way, are not a simple rebellion. They've been around for 9 centuries. People have forgotten, but up until 1962, there was an independent, autonomous, sovereign state in the Mutawakkilit Kingdom of Yemen, that had a seat at the United Nations. And the Nasser, the Egyptian head of state, at one point tried to crush them and ended up with 55,000 dead Egyptian soldiers. That's what's going to happen to the Sudanese mercenaries that are today in Yemen, who has a job that is worse than Afghanistan. Iran is also in Afghanistan today because of water issues within Herat. So when we end up with this nuclear issue and talk about nuclear matters in Iran, and Trump saying that Iran is a terrorist, the selected version of identifying terrorists. You know, I've always been surprised at the double standard that some people can actually openly utilize and finger point at someone and not talk about something else. You can get, for example, your head chopped off in Saudi Arabia, and you've never heard Trump say anything about it, but something goes wrong in Iran and you have the entire Trump administration howling out of DC. So Iran today is in a difficult situation. That is why this nuclear issue is our problem. Why? Because the Rouhani regime promised to the Iranian people that this nuclear agreement is going to open up the doors of the country to foreign investment, that hundreds of billions of dollars will be invested in Iran. And he can actually offer the Iranian youth, the 70% who are under the age of 40, something aside from a continuous promise of restrictions on civil liberties and unemployment. That's what the regime is promising the Iranian youth. No job, no future, no nothing, and you're not even authorized to freely express yourself politically. They hoped that the pursuit of the JCPOA, positive consequences would appear, final blessing would come, and they would actually have something to offer to the Iranian youth. And this has been a total failure. I have set up an office in Tehran where I practice law over there to the number of French expats that we have over there, and I can assure you that aside from some significant lead deals that have occurred, such as the Sabre-Josie-Croyne deal or the Total deal, there's not much going on. The level of investment prior to the adoption of the nuclear agreement in Iran and interaction with the European Union was $4 billion. Today, it's 12. McKinsey drafted a report Iran, the new El Dorado, the new market, whose return to the international financial system would be equivalent to that of all of the countries of Eastern Europe united after the fall of the Berlin Wall. But nothing of that nature has happened. The volume of exchanges with Europe has now only nearly tripled to 12 billion. It's nothing. Insignificant. So the Iranian regime today is looking at some at its own population, and the Iranian regime today, and the government per se, is in a dangerous situation. Why? Because the youth, who represent the majority of the Iranian population, are totally disappointed. And furthermore, the conservative centers of power in Iran are waiting for this JCPOA, this nuclear deal, just to blow away for them to be able to finger point the Iranian government and tell them that we told you, you can't trust the Americans. So let us get back into power. What would that imply? They would do whatever they can to destroy the entente that has occurred with They will begin shooting ballistic missiles all over the place just to create a situation provoking the Americans so that in turn they would themselves be provoked and end up in a never-ending thermal circle of mutual provocation and finally obtaining what they direly and desperately hope that they would end up with, which is the total exclusion of Iran from the international community. That is what we don't want to happen. Because in today's world, and I'll finish with this small comment over here, this war of civilizations that we have, which we have. I mean, people are criticizing Sam Huntington by saying that, you know, your concept of war of civilizations is outdated and it's not politically correct. But it is pertinent. The problem is that we're not pointing at the right direction. The civilizational war that we're involved in today, because there is one, between our, I didn't even utilize the word Judeo-Christian or Western, that doesn't mean anything. Because of our civilizations where we live and let other people live. We accept the other's difference. Tolerant societies where democracy prevails. Our societies are at war against a certain version of Islam. That is a reality. That is at war against us. That is shooting at our children and families in our own streets and movie theaters. And this version of Islam is the Wahhabi Salafi version of Islam, that of ISIS. There are 1.4 billion Muslims on this planet. The Wahhabis are 5 million. 5 million. Saudi Arabia is a country of 28 million. Half of them are foreign workers. Foreign workers, Pakistanis, Indonesians, who are earning $200 a month and being treated as slaves with their passports confiscated. The other half are Saudis. That makes them 14 million. One third of are Shia, the 5 million concentrated in northeastern part of Saudi Arabia. The other third are members of other faith Muslim schools, such as the Hanafi or the Maliki schools that are dominant in Iraq or in the UAE, for example. Not all Saudi citizens are Wahhabis. So you have a country of 5 million people who is in control of the largest oil reserves in the world, financing madrasas and religious schools across the globe, changing the moderate version of Islam that was omnipresent the further you were from its center, Mecca. Pakistan, for example, who had a version of moderate Islam, of mausoleums, of the Sufi faith, transforming them into fanatical Wahhabis through the use of oil. So you have an entire religion, more than 1 billion people, taken hostage by a group of 5 million people. This is what is at stake today, and this is what the Saudis want to assure its perennity over time, and this is what the Iranians feel is an existential threat for them, because they believe that if they don't fight ISIS in Iraq, if they don't fight ISIS in Damascus, they will be compelled to fight ISIS within their own national territories. This is the view from Tehran. And I believe in today's world, the choice of identifying what is happening is even non-existent. Choosing between Iran and Saudi Arabia shouldn't even exist. Iran and the Iranians are people who resemble, you know, we've got specimens of them over here, Saddam, myself. We are not people who walk around the streets with a blanket over our heads, shoving people's heads off. Iran is different. Iran is Indo-European. And Iran is a natural ally of Europe. And today, with the Trump administration, who's chosen, on one side, to concentrate exclusively its strategy from a Saudi sheikdom point of view of the Persian Gulf. And, it should be mentioned, his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, who is a member of the far-right religious community of the Jewish faith in America, and by the way, the vast majority of American Jews are totally liberal, they voted for Hillary Clinton, only an extreme minority voted for Trump, those who are pro-settlers, those who are anti-two-state solution, those are the people who are the right wing of the Likud party, which is already on the right side of the Israeli political spectrum. So you have a Trump strategy who looks at the Middle East, who looks at Iran, and sees through the eyes of Saudi Arabia and the Likud. This will reach a problem. That's why all through these years and my comments and my articles, what I try to convey to Western societies, my last sentence, is that Iran, far from being the problem, may be at least part of the solution.
Yes, I know that you have to leave at what time? I have to leave exactly at 7:30.
Okay,
so you have 4 minutes to ask questions. So go ahead, if there are any questions,
Do you think that the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia will go to a war with Iran?
No. Why? They can't even take care of the poorest, the weakest Arab country, that is Yemen, and the Houthi movement in Yemen. How do you want them to take care of a country of 83 million educated, sophisticated people in Iran? It cannot happen. Even the Israelis, if you read the Haaretz newspaper or the video of Arba, they're saying, the Israelis should not do the dirty work of the Saudis. So the Saudis have no possibility whatsoever of getting engaged in a war. And the power of Iran in a specific case is not as if Iran is actually militarily occupying the Arab world. Iran has become part of the Arab world. The Shia in Iraq, the Hashid movement, who fought side by side with the Iraqi army, are Iraqis. They're just Shia. And they have remembered what happened to them 2003, when George H. Bush, before that, attacked Iraq and stopped at the Iraqi frontier, leaving the Shia in the south of Iraq to be massacred by Saddam Hussein. And they remember one thing, that at the end of the day, the Iranians may not be Arabs, the Iraqi Arabs may not so much like the Iranians, but they know that worse comes to worse, at least they will be there to stand by them when there is a threat for them. So the strength of Iran is that Iran has become part of the Arab world. The Shia community in Iraq looked towards Iran for help and assistance and guidance. Same thing in Syria. They were not massacred because the Iranian regime sent in its experts and managed to create a local army, protect the Syrian regime. And that same thing everywhere. But the strength of Iran is that it has not led a war of aggression for more than 250 years. But its weakness is that its image abroad does not correspond to the reality of Iran. When you imagine Iran, you're imagining a country of bearded mullahs walking around with baseball bats, kicking people and taking over embassies. It is also that, but it's not like that every day. It's not like that every day. So whether there will be war between Saudi Arabia and Iran, I don't think so. And the Saudis know well that if there is a war, and there was a war, Daesh movement, the ISIS movement, was populated by Saudis. The Iraqi Prime Minister Hyder Abad said that more than 40% of the entire constituency of the ISIS army was exclusively comprised of Saudi nationals. So this war occurred, this proxy war between Iran and the Saudi ISIS against the Hashemite pro-Iranian movement. And the result was that ISIS was decimated. The Saudis have learned that lesson as well.
I have a question. Why is it Israel so against the Iranian nuclear deal, given the fact that within the framework of the Middle East, Israel and Iranian are the two stable states? In my opinion, they should work together, given the chaos around.
There is a distinction to be made between, once again, Netanyahu and Israeli governmental and institutional apparatus, as there is a distinction to be made between Trump and what America is about. The Crown Prince Ali, Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, thinks that he has struck a deal, he's striking the deal with America. No, he has just managed to do a deal with Trump, not with America. That's why after Trump, what he's going to end up with is going to be a hostile U.S. administration. When you look at Israel, you're looking at the Trump administration, but the centers of power in Israel are not exclusively, I'm sorry, within the Netanyahu administration. You're looking at the secret services, the Shin Bet, the Mossad, the army, and all of these institutions. When Netanyahu was genuinely considering striking Iran to an airstrike, they went on television. They went on television saying, we do not believe it is in the interest of Israel for Israel to end up in a war or strike militarily Iran. There's a documentary on this subject where all the six past heads of the Mossad went online and mentioned the fact that they are not believers in Trump. Netanyahu's aggressive strategy against Iran. And when you're so right in the sense that Israeli military defense is no longer adequate to protect Israel. The 400 nuclear warheads were pertinent when you had Arab nation states with a huge conventional army. But where is Saddam Hussein's army? Where is the army of the Hafez al-Assad in Syria? Where is Nasser's army in Egypt? There is no longer an Arab nation state today standing. We're all decimated by the Arab Spring. So what is the purpose of having nukes and warheads all around the place when the threat is coming from ISIS and your frontier or Hamas and your frontier? It's as if you wanted to launch a nuclear bomb at the Mubarak Tower. It won't be a solution for you. So Israel needs to strike a deal with the Iranians because the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And Israel and Iran are hated by the same people, the aggressive, minority, fanatical, Sunni Wahhabi movement. They are the ones that need to be eradicated. And Israel and Iran understand this. The problem is, as long as we've got Netanyahu in Iran, or in Israel, as long as we've got the Iranian Supreme Leader, that is not about to happen. But nobody's eternal.
How can Iran promote this version of, moderate version of Islam, especially in the West?
With the great luck of the Shia, you know, people should also know, it's interesting to read this.
Not Shia Islam, but moderate Islam.
This version of Shia Islam is interesting, because Shia Islam in Iran only goes back to the 16th century. The Islamic faith goes back 14 centuries ago. So it's a modern invention by the Safavid dynasty, distinguishing itself from the Ottomans, the Turkish-speaking and Sunni, like themselves. So it's a political decision to become Shia. A book that I recommend, it's called The Shia Revival, excellent subject called Vali Nas, who's the dean of the School of International Relations at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, which should be read, which correctly summarizes this. But the big difference between Shia and Sunni faith, from an ideological point of view, is that within the Shia faith, you have a clerical hierarchy, which you don't have in the Sunni faith. And this clerical hierarchy within the Shia faith is a consequence of the continuity of Zoroastrian faith in Iran after the Arab invasion, because the Zoroastrians had their own system of the clergy. So what has happened is that because you've got a high level clergy, because you have grand ayatollahs, and we have four of them, you can change the law from the top down. In the Sunni faith, anyone can call themselves a mullah, an imam, go to a basement in the suburbs of Paris and launch a fatwa, a religious order, a decree. In the Shia, it is impossible. So the fact that change can come from the top implies that tomorrow, for example, alcohol could be authorized. The wearing of the scarf for women could be authorized. A removal of scarf could be authorized. Anything can happen coming from the top of them. And furthermore, the Shia, being a minority, have managed to understand how difficult it is to live amongst people who are a majority and who do not share their faith. So the level of tolerance within the Shia faith is higher than that of the Sunni faith. But what may change is primarily because of the clergy that exists in the Shia faith, and because Iran has earned its credibility in the Arab street, pursuant to the Hezbollah War of 2006 in Israel, pursuant to standing up to America, etc., etc. Iran is not popular in the Arab chanceries and palaces and governments, but is popular in the Arab street. And one of the mortal mistakes that the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia made was that by ostracizing Qatar, they handed over Qatar to Iran, and they handed over the Muslim Brotherhood to Iran, which is in government and ruling in Turkey, managed to put Turks and Iranians together, and managed to allow the Iranians to have their say in the Arab street, beginning from Hamas and Gaza.
Thank you.